greetings of Jesus. Last night we warned about a couple of things, one of which was the pseudoscience of psychology, and the other was the vain philosophies of the world. Now again, there is biblical psychology, which understands that man is tripartite and has a body, a soul, and a spirit. We are not simply, again, proverbial baboons with better DNA, as Darwinism says. Biblical psychology is the book of Proverbs, and there's much more to Proverbs than biblical psychology, but it is a book of biblical psychology. If you want to understand human behavior, why people think and behave the way they do, read Proverbs. Don't read Freud, don't read Jung, don't read Maslow. Read Proverbs. Proverbs is scriptural psychology. It's divine psychology. So too, we have the vain philosophies of the world. But that's not to say there's not divine philosophy. There is. Divine philosophy is what we call in Hebrew, Megillat Kohelet, the scroll of Ecclesiastes. And it's ritually read annually during the Feast of Tabernacles in a booth. God's philosophy is simple. If you trust in this life or this world, it's all in vain. It's all vanity. It's all going to be in vain. Make the best of a bad thing. The world is fallen. Love God and keep His commandments. If you set your heart on this place, it doesn't matter how successful or wealthy or how long you live, it's all going to be in vain. You're going to end your life in utter disappointment unless you love God and keep His commandments. It's all vanity. Turn with me, please, to the book of Ecclesiastes, chapter 1. The words of the preacher, that's the Kohelet. Solomon. The son of David, king of Jerusalem. Vanity of vanities, says the preacher. Vanity of vanities. All is vanity. It's all in vain. It reiterates it. In the Vulgate, Latin Vulgate, it's really interesting. Vanitas, vanitate, omnia vanitas. It's all in vain. But skip down, please, to verse 8. There are many things that people have cited in the song of, I'm sorry, in the book of Ecclesiastes that referred to trade winds, to meteorological patterns, to condensation, things that were in the scripture centuries before they were known by science, by man, but they're in here. And commencing in verse 8, all things are wearisome. Man is not able to tell it. The eye is not satisfied with seeing, nor is the ear filled with hearing. Quite a thing. The eye is never satisfied with seeing, or the ear with hearing. You can be attracted to the most beautiful man or woman in the world, and half hour later, somebody else is going to catch your fancy. But because of the fall of man, we become insatiable. In a perverse kind of way, we're insatiable. But then it goes on. That which has been is that which will be. That which has been done is that which will be done. So there's nothing new under the sun. And Akhtava Chadash, Tachat HaShemesh. Is there anything of which one might say, see, this is new? It's already existed for ages, which were before us. There's no remembrance of earlier things, and also of the later things which will occur. There will be for them no remembrance among those who will come still later. I, the preacher, have been king over Israel and Jerusalem, and I set my mind to seek and explore my wisdom concerning all that's been done under heaven. It is a grievous task that God has given to the sons of men to be afflicted with. The more you know, the more vexed you're going to become. The more you understand the nature of the human condition in a fallen world, the more frustrating it becomes. It's an affliction. in many books, it's only going to be more affliction. The more you know, the more you're going to become vexed. On the other hand, you can't say the dumber you are, the better you are, but maybe can you say the smarter you are, the better off you are. The whole thing is fallen. I've seen all the works which have been done under the sun, and behold, all is vanity and striving after the wind. What is crooked cannot be straightened, and what is lacking cannot be counted. I said to myself, behold, I magnified and increased wisdom more than all who were over Jerusalem before me. My mind has observed a wealth of wisdom and knowledge. I set my mind to know wisdom and to know madness and folly. And I realize this also is striving after the wind. Because in much wisdom there is much grief. And increasing knowledge results in increasing pain. Isn't that encouraging? Isn't that a wonderful advert for higher education? Unbelievable. But that's the way it is. Now God says to get knowledge, but it's a grievous task He's afflicted us with, in the hope that by realizing the futility of this life, we won't trust in it. It's all in vain. It's all vanity. There's nothing new under the sun. That which has been is that which will be. That which has been done is that which will be done. Can anyone say this is new? No. There's nothing new under the sun. Nothing new under the sun. It's been said by various people that if we do not learn the lessons of history, we're doomed to repeat its mistakes. One civilization after another has rebuilt cities on major fault zones. When there's a successive history of earthquakes. Even the most advanced civilizations in the world have done that since ancient times. Unbelievable. Unbelievable. Anybody can bolt the proverbial barn door after the horse escapes. Churchill said, we need to stop Hitler now at Munich. But they didn't want to listen to Churchill. Well, if they'd stopped Hitler at Munich, they would have saved themselves a lot of trouble. London, Liverpool, and Coventry wouldn't have burned, and the Holocaust and the Blitz wouldn't have happened. But they didn't stop. Pick up a newspaper today. It's crazy people in North Korea. MacArthur wanted to stop the North Koreans in the late 1940s, and I'm sorry, the early 1950s. He said, if we don't stop these people now, we're going to wish we did. And we're going to have no mistake. Nobody learns history. It doesn't matter. No civilization has ever learned from history. None. You read the books of Kings and Chronicles, Israel and the Jews made the same mistakes cyclically. It's all futile. The more you study history, the more frustrating it becomes because we see people always do the same stupid things. Unbelievable. And it goes on and on. Can anyone say this is new? Now the people of God, in the sense of Israel, God wanted them to know better. But He also wants the church to know better. It's not new. If you trust in it, it's not going to work. It's going to be frustrating. Once upon a time. Right now in modern Israel, there is a rebirth of the body of Christ. The numbers of Jews getting saved, although not astronomical, are unprecedented since the early centuries of Christianity. But the same problems are springing up. You've got people in Israel, Orthodox Jews, some of them, Orthodox, who are known in Israel, they call them secret believers. And they're afraid of being rejected by their family and shunned by the community, but they'll meet with believers secretly and things, and you talk to them. There's a problem. Jesus said, "Let there be, you know, if you don't confess me before men, I won't confess you before my Father." People go, "Oh, he's a believer. He's a secret believer. He's a secret believer. How do you know he is one?" When you talk to these people, a number of them say, "Well, we agree he's the Messiah, but he's not God." This was in the first century, the same. They were called Ebionites. Ebionites. They were around the first century, second century, third century. They lasted into the fourth century. There are people even in your country, and I've met some of them, in South Africa, as well as many other countries. These people are not Jewish, nor are they married to people who are Jewish. Yet, you see them wearing yarmulkes, putting on tefillin, in a legalistic way, observing the Hebrew feasts. Now, don't get me wrong, Christians need to understand the doctrinal theology of the Hebrew feasts and how they're fulfilled in Christ and what they mean prophetically. Christians need to learn those feasts in terms of what they mean spiritually and theologically, doctrinally. You need to understand that he's the Paschal Lamb and so forth. That's very true. But to actually impose a culture that's totally alien to people is absurd. It says don't do that in Acts 15. It says don't do that in 1 Corinthians 7. But they're doing it. And they call themselves Messianic. But when you go to their congregations, they're not synagogues, they're synagogues. And they've got rabbis calling themselves rabbis who don't know anything about rabbinics. Most of them don't even speak Hebrew. Well, this is nuts. But it's not new. These are Neo-Galatians. This happened in the early church. But these are things simply related to God's people, Israel. Once upon a time, there were believers who were confusing mysticism with spirituality, who were speaking in tongues in meetings ecstatically, thinking they were having divine revelations and messages. That was a lot of gibberish. They were having prophecies that they thought was the Lord giving them some kind of prophetic revelation, but it was just nonsense. And they were consumed by it. They were enthusiastic. They were ignoring scripture in favor of experience. And they had a high level of carnality. You find out that these same people are always talking about the Holy Spirit, forget about the fact that he's the Spirit of holiness. And they get into immorality. And they even configure their own belief system where they would say, "I'm a new creation. It doesn't matter what the old creation does." They pervert the grace of God into licentiousness. The Lord only sees the blood of Jesus. He doesn't see my sin. Without taking into account that the grace of God is designed to bring us to repentance. Well, this lunacy is what we've seen in the modern charismatic movement. But it didn't begin with the modern charismatic movement or 20th century Pentecostalism. There were people being saved out of paganism in the Peloponnese and ancient Greece in the first century. That is what place with the Delphic Oracle was. And she was being thrown on top of a sulfur pit and inhaled the fumes. And she began having hallucinations induced chemically by the inhalation of sulfuric thiamine. And she began to yodel. And the priests of Delphi would interpret this yodeling as prophetic messages. People being saved out of this culture would bring it with them into the church. And then practice tongues the same way. All out of order, all chaotic. Paul says that the ungifted or the unbelieving enter, will I not say you are mad? If an unsaved person, and some did, saw the film footage of Rodney Brown and Kenneth Copeland, Mike Evans, they say, well, Matt, well, this went on in the early church in Corinth. Today in Singapore, there's a false teacher. His name is Joseph Prince. False teacher. He teaches hyper grace. Forget about the fact that the scripture is emphatic. The grace of God is designed to bring repentance. We warrant the judgment of God, but he withholds it as a gesture of his love, the hope that we will repent, that we will not come under his judgment. No, you can live this, you're still a believer. This was the problem in Corinth. Joseph Prince is not new, he thinks he's new. People following that deceiver think it's new. But there's nothing new about Joseph Prince. There's nothing new about what he's teaching or what he's doing. There's nothing new on this. Once upon a time, an international phenomenon took place that was explosive within the body of Christ. And people heard that there was a move of God taking place at a certain city. And if you went there, you'd get the blessing and get in the move of God. And that the kind of charismatic power in the early church that was witnessed in the ministry of the apostles is taking place again. And this is the revival, and God is going forward. He's doing a new thing. He's pouring out his spirit in a new way. And you've got to go there to get the blessing. And all kinds of people begin going to this city to get this blessing and bring it back to their native churches and their native homelands. Well, you can be forgiven if you think I was talking about the Toronto experience. But the city was not Toronto. It was Papusa, an ancient Phrygia. These people were called Montanists. Third century. Montanists. Actually, they were towards the end of the second century, into the third. And people began getting caught up in it who you never would have imagined, including the church father, Tertullian, a lawyer, an educated person. All kinds of people began going to Papusa, churches sending delegations to Papusa to be prophesied over, to get hands laid up so they'd get the blessing and bring it back. This was the move of God. God is restoring the church in power. This is the great revival. It's happening in Papusa, and now God wants it to happen everywhere. Go to Papusa and get it. You can call it Toronto, You can call it Pensacola. You can call it Lakeland. But it's just Papusa. Why? Because that which has been is that which will be. That which has been done is that which will be done. There's nothing new under the sun. Is there anything anyone might say, see, this is new? No, it has already existed from ages earlier, which were before us. But there's no remembrance of that. There's nothing new under the sun. No revival came from Montanism. What you see today is simply neo-Montanism. That's all it is. Charismania. Once upon a time, there was a group of believers who claimed that there was an angelic vision. And this angelic vision came, and an angel pointed something out to some people, particularly a woman and women, and then other people, saying that we have to worship on Saturday instead of on Sunday. And this became a divisive issue. And those who worshiped on Sunday were accused of violating the Lord's ordinance of the Sabbath. And it became something that took on a cultic dimension and threatened to split the church. Well, this sounds just like Ellen G. White. It sounds just like the Seventh-day Adventists. This is Colossae. Read Colossians chapter 2, verses 16 to 19. Just look at it. Therefore, no one is to act as your judge in regard to food or drink. Seventh-day Adventists are into dietary legalism, aren't they? Or in respect to a festival, a new moon, or a Sabbath. I once met Little Richard, the rock and roll singer in Los Angeles at 5 o'clock in the morning at the airport in Los Angeles. And he gave me a book. The first half of the book was all scriptural. There's nothing in there I couldn't disagree. I couldn't agree with my opinion and everything. The second half was all this dietary and sabbatary legalism. It's a Seventh-day Adventist. Regard to food or drink with respect to a festival, a new moon, or a Sabbath. Things are mere shadow of what is to come, but the substance belongs to Christ. Let no one keep defrauding you of your prize by delighting in the self effacement and worship of angels, taking his stand on a vision he's seen, inflated without cause by his fleshly mind. That's Ellen G. White. And the angel appeared there and pointed out the commandment of the Sabbath. No, nine of the Ten Commandments are reiterated in the New Testament. A specific day for the Sabbath is not. But an angel showed her. Islam. Mormonism. Ancient Corinthianism. Seventh-day Adventism. All of those false belief systems, every one of them, comes from somebody claiming an angelic revelation. You see it in Roman Catholicism and Fatima and all these things, but it is Seventh-day Adventists, Mormons, Islam, they all claim the angel appeared, but Muhammad got the Quran from the gate. Every one of them does the same thing. None of these things are new. None of these things are new. No, none of them. There's nothing new under the sun. Once upon a time, there were people who claimed we have to be baptized on behalf of the dead to save them. And so we'll be baptized in order to have posthumous salvation. And they began becoming obsessed with things like birth and death records to see who they can save after they die. This sounds like the Mormons. That's what the Mormons do. They have little idea that Paul was referring to a pagan Greek belief in the afterlife, because the Greeks and other civilizations, not only the Jews, had baptism, forms of it. They take something that was referring to a non-Christian practice and they try to make it Christian until we don't know what they're doing. The Corinthians did this in the second century. Mormons didn't invent this stuff. Mormonism is a lot of nonsense. Once upon a time, during the time of tremendous social and cultural upheaval, someone came along and began to preach the following message: that there are three ages. Old Testament Israel was the age of the Father. The New Testament Church is the age of the Son. But now God is doing something new by His Spirit. This is the age of the Spirit. We must come into the fullness of the Spirit and place the emphasis on the Spirit, because this is what God is doing that is something new. He's going to move on now. The same as He moved on with Israel to the church, now He's moving on with the church into the age of the Spirits. You don't get on board with it, God's just going to leave you in the dust. He's going to move on without you. You've got to come in to the fullness of the Spirit. You've got to understand what God is revealing now by His Spirit and what He wants to do in this age of the Spirit. Well, this sounds very much like the late John Wimber and the Vineyard Movement, doesn't it? Sounds very much like him. Has roots in Azusa Street and things like that, but it was the Vineyard Movement climactically thought this way. I was not, however, thinking of Azusa Street or the Vineyard Movement. This was Jotham of Fiore, the 11th century. And it took Christendom by storm. That which has been is that which will be. That which has been done is that which will be done. So there's nothing new under the sun. Is there anything of which one might say, see, it's new? No. it's already existed from ages which before us, but there's no remembrance of the earlier days. Once upon a time, the world of Christendom was in a frenzy. It took on an apocalyptic dimension. People said it's the end of the millennium. It's going to be a new millennium. And when the clock strikes midnight for the new millennium, there's going to be global pandemonium. Everything is going to go mad. Chaos will reign supreme. It will unleash apocalyptic events. Open the door for tribulation, for the fulfillment of end time prophecy. It's going to be something that's coming. We only have a few years left to the end of the millennium. We only have a few months left to the end of the millennium. We only have a few weeks left to the end of the millennium. Countdown, get ready. We only have a few days left when chaos will fall. Utter pandemonium. Countdown for the new millennium. Are you ready for the apocalypse? Fasten your seatbelt. Well, you would remember that as Y2K. I was speaking of Y1K. 9989. Pope Sylvester. People began giving their land and their castles and their farms to the Pope. It was the end of the millennium. Jesus was coming. Because Augustine persuaded people, when Constantine pseudo-Christianized the Roman Empire, that the age of the church is the millennial reign of Christ. So everybody gave all their wealth, and people gave giving their wealth and their lands and everything to the church and to the Pope. Nobody got their money back. Nobody. Nope. I set my mind to know wisdom, to know madness, to know folly. The people who fell for Y2K, which was a big con job and a nonsense, are the same kinds of people who fell for Y1K, which was a big con job and a nonsense, propagated by ignorant people, sensationalists. They were just sensations. There's nothing wrong with this. Nothing. Once upon a time, there were people who said, we're Christians. And we're dissatisfied with the mundane, stale, spiritually stagnant state of the church. That's because people are in control of the church. The Lord is no longer in control of it by His Spirit. But His Spirit is trying to witness to us as the inner light. We're not going to have church anymore in the traditional sense, coming with our programs or our planned sermon or a liturgy, or any expectation. That's not. We're the people of the Spirit. We don't want any more leadership as such, any clergy, anything like that. We're all friends. Friends in the Lord. And so we'll just, instead of having a church, we'll have a meeting. And we'll meet together and wait on the Lord to reveal to us what He wants to say. We'll wait on the Lord to reveal to us what He wants to do. We'll just wait on the Lord instead of acting in the flesh. We'll wait on Him. He will guide us by His inner light. Have thine own way, Lord. We are the sheep of your pasture. Have thine own way. We're waiting on you, Lord. I've known people like that. There's home groups like that. There's people who say things like that now. Actually, I was speaking of the Quakers, the Society of Friends in the 17th century. The inner light told them to do all kinds of things, especially things that were contrary to Scripture. Like get rid of baptism, get rid of the Lord's Supper. And then to demonstrate their freedom in Christ to run naked through the streets of Buckinghamshire, England. They ran into all kinds of trouble in England. But one of them, who'd been a disciple of one of their founders, or the main founder, George Fox, again, I'm not saying these guys were not sincere. His father was an admiral in the Royal Navy, but an aristocrat to whom the king owed money. And the king gave him land in colonial America, today known as Pennsylvania. The Quakers went over that, because they didn't want them in England anymore. What were they going to do, crazy? They became radical pacifists. They became nuns. They did crazy things. These were the Quakers of the 17th century. You hear people saying that kind of stuff, and not the first ones who said things like that. And they're going to end up in the same kind of chaos invariably that the previous ones did. The reason that will happen is there's no remembrance of earlier things. I don't remember what happened. It's not an old song. Once upon a time, there were people who said, you know, you're born again and you're saved by grace and, you know, justified by faith in the completed work of Jesus. And you believe the scriptures as we do. And you're our brethren, but you're missing something. You're missing the full power of the Spirit. You've got to open up to it, because the Lord is doing something powerful now, and you've got to come out of this stained version of evangelicism and get the power. And the emphasis became on the power. And when you do that, the Lord will give you prophecies, exhortations, predictions of what's going to come. It's going to be tremendous. And this power that will be spoken into being by prophetic ministry is going to unleash the power of the Lord to bring revival. That's what they said. That's what Mike Bickle at IHOP says. That's what the Kansas City prophets say. But actually, I was thinking of the cattle profits. The aftermath of the Reformation in the 16th century. It wasn't Kansas City, it was Munster, Germany. And they were absolutely ballistic. Among other things, there was a torrent of sexual scandal and perversion of every kind imaginable. Christian wife swapping. A kind of perverse libertarianism where there was no restraints on behavior because they were free in the spirit. They said, predictions that didn't happen. Just like the homosexual alcoholic Paul Kane. Kansas City false prophets. Bob Jones and Mike Bickle and these same craziness. But of course, the Kansas City prophet said, God's doing something new. Mike Bickle told the young people, the Lord is doing something that's new. No, it wasn't no. I'd set my mind to know wisdom and to know madness and folly. Can anyone say this is new? There's nothing new under the sun. Nothing. Absolutely nothing. Once upon a time, there were people who said, Jesus is not divine, he's not God. He's in some sense the Savior, and he's the Christ, but he's not God. He's an angel. When he prayed to his father, that proves he wasn't God. He was an angel. That's who he really was. Well, this sounds just like the Jehovah's Witnesses. They can't seem to deal with Hebrews chapter 1. But I wasn't thinking of the Jehovah's Witnesses. Not at all. I was thinking of the Arians, the 3rd century. Charles Taze Russell, Nathan Knorr, they thought they invented, they think it's... When you look at what the Jehovah's Witnesses say and believe, it is beyond absurd. For instance, the name of God, Jehovah, they have no idea what Jehovah really comes from. In Hebrew, the Tetragrammaton, Yahweh, Yehovah. When they put it into Yiddish, the European Jews put it into Yiddish, they combine the accents and syllables with of Adonai, Lord. Like when it says the Lord is my shepherd, in Hebrew it actually says Yahweh is my shepherd. They combine the accents and syllables of Lord, Adonai, Adonai, with the Tetragrammaton, Yehovah. Adonai, Yehovah, Yehovah. That's what Jehovah means. It comes from Yiddish, combining the accents and syllables of two different Hebrew words. Names, of a name and a title word. They have no idea. It's utterly silly. But they think it's new. They think it's new. They think it was revealed to Charles Taze Russell, and think it's new. It's ludicrous. Any religious Jew will tell you it's ludicrous. They think Armageddon is a valley. Har Megiddo, Mount Megiddo. It's not a valley, it's a mount. The valley is Emek Israel. Har Megiddo is the mount that overlooks the valley. Ain't no idea. This idea that Michael was the angel's Jesus, they have no idea. They think it was new to them. Some cults will emphasize things like education to try to give credibility to the cult or false religions. Talmudic Judaism, Roman Catholicism, they'll emphasize education. Like you've got Catholic universities in the States, Notre Dame and Georgetown, they don't have credibility. The Mormons, that Brigham Young University, they want to have credibility, you know. The Orthodox will have Yeshiva University, they want to have credibility. The Jehovah's Witnesses, they discourage education. They're generally uneducated people. And they're kept that way. They're told it's a waste of time, you know. So they'll believe, when you have somebody who doesn't know anything, they'll believe anything. When you have people who don't know anything, they're going to believe anything. And they think it's new. It's very sad. Once upon a time, there were people who had a particular hermeneutic. The way they interpreted the scripture was based on a kind of paradigm that constructed a radical discontinuity between the God of the Old Testament and the God of the New, or the way he behaved in one and the way he behaved in the other. And there were people, these people, saying things like, the Sermon on the Mount is not for the church. The Sermon on the Mount is for Israel. Jesus was preaching to the Jews before his crucifixion and resurrection. Sermon on the Mount is for the Jews, not the church. And then they would say, the Epistle of Jude to the 12 tribes of Israel, that's not for the church, that's part of the Old Testament. And then they'd say the Olivet Discourse, Matthew 24, Luke 21, the return of Christ. Well, that's Jesus, he's talking to the Jews. He's not talking to the church. And some of them would even take it further and say the Gospels are not for Christians. The Christian canon begins in the book of Acts with Paul and the Pentecost. Well, this sounds like John Nelson Darby and the Close Brethren, or it sounds like Bullinger and the followers. There's a sect in this country that apologized to the Bullinger. They were refuted by various people. The dispensationalists refuted them. But unfortunately, Harry Ironside proposed them and things like that. They believe this stuff. Remember, John Nelson Darby, the primary architect of pre-tribulationism, he was publicly, in secular newspapers, publicly castigated by Charles Spurgeon. Spurgeon warned against him. George Mueller, you heard of George Mueller? Publicly warned against Darby. Benjamin Newton, even many of the Plymouth Brethren, the Tregelis and Newton warned against Darby, said he was a nut. Spurgeon warned people, he took out a full page out of the newspapers telling people that Darby was a nut, a despot. The group that he founded, the Close Brethren, they were cults. But I wasn't thinking about hyper-dispensationalists or Bullingerists. Although their Christology was different, the way they handled or mishandled the scripture, these were the mm-hmm. Marcionites. And they were around in the second century. Barbie didn't begin this stuff. Bollinger didn't begin this stuff that Spurgeon and Hugo warned against. I don't know. Once upon a time, there were people who said, the Father's Jesus, Jesus is Jesus, and the Holy Spirit is Jesus. It's a trinity of manifestation. You have to get baptized in the name of Jesus only. You have to understand, when you see somebody pushing Jesus only, being baptized in the name of Jesus only, the issue is not baptism. The issue is they don't believe in one God of three persons. That's the real issue. No, the Father is Jesus, Jesus is Jesus, and the Holy Spirit is Jesus. Well, this sounds like these silly Texans you have running around in Cockstead now with cowboy boots and 10-gallon hats. I assure you, not all Texans are silly and they don't all believe that, but you've got the fruitcakes who've been exported. Unbelievable. This kind of belief system is called modalism. There are different, in the Eastern Church, it's called Patripassianism. I'm sorry, Patripassianism in the Western Church, in the Eastern Church. These were the Sabellians. They're the Sabellians. They're around the 3rd century. Believe the same thing as these Texans. These Texans think they're the one true church in Cockstead because they believe that Jesus is Jesus, the Father is Jesus, and the Holy Spirit is Jesus. A true story. I know this account is accurate. Someone was disputing with such people, and not locally, but this took place in Britain. And showed them the martyrdom of Stephen. Jesus is at the right hand of the Father. And Stephen was filled with the Spirit. So there you have the Spirit, you have the Father, and you have the Son. 3. And the Sabellian, the Jesus only, the United Pentecostal, the cowboy, whatever you want to call him. This is what the response was. If somebody was hitting you in the head with rocks, you'd be seeing double and triple time. That was their response. I set my mind to know wisdom, to know madness and folly. Can anyone say this is new? No, it's not new. There is nothing new. Well, once upon a time, there were people who began saying that when the Holy Spirit is outpoured in power, people will manifest in such a way as they will do things that will not make sense to other people. And the power of God will be upon them so powerfully they can't control it. They forget about the fact that the scripture tells us twice the fruit of the Spirit is ekaite, self-control. And the fact that you can't control it proves it's not the Holy Spirit. They forget about the fact that when they would say, when the Spirit of God is on me, I have to prophesy, hallelujah, like Jesse Duplantis. Ignoring the scripture that tells us the spirit of the prophets is subject to the prophets. No, the spirit's on you. Don't suppress it. Just go with the flow. It's the power of God. Hallelujah. And they began to shake and vibrate and roll down the aisles. The church, they got the nicknames of being holy rollers and things like this. And they'd be going, hallelujah, hallelujah. They'd be rolling around and jumping. Well, this sounds a lot like hyper-Pentecostalism. I've been to meetings where that happens. There are a lot of churches in Central Africa where that happens. Nigeria, it's just crazy. Craziness. And they think it's the spirit. Actually, I was talking about a group called the Shakers. Century. They began in England and came to America, to Albany, New York, the first little colony. Named after, that was their colony by the airport in Albany, New York, and upstate New York now. And they got into the thing where the Lord was coming, so don't get married. And so they could only grow by getting people to join their group. And I think the last two died about 10 years ago, or maybe somewhere within the last 8, 15 years, 10 years ago, let's say. And there was two of them left. And they were holding on to this teaching that they got from this lady they called Mother something or other, who came from Manchester, England. And they came to the States and they were doing this stuff. They've been around for generations doing it. Others have copied it. These were the Shakers. We have the Quakers, the Shakers. If you turn on Christian TV and watch Ray McCauley, you'll see the Fakers. Well, they've always been around in one form or another. These things have always been around in one form or another. I recall doing evangelism when I was in seminary back in London, England. And I'd go down to Speaker's Corner in Hyde Park on Sunday after church with my stepladder to do evangelism, preach the gospel, be heckled by the Muslims and ridiculed by the nuts and that, but down there, there's a group of preachers down there. Some of them good, some of them not so good, but I'd go down there pretty much every Sunday after church with my stepladder to do some evangelism. And kiss my wife and the kids goodbye, then go home, and I go to the Speaker's Corner. And I was down there, and some guy came from America, and he had these booklets. This was 88 reasons why Jesus was coming on Yom Kippur of 1987. And then when Jesus didn't show up on Yom Kippur of 1987, he said he had the year wrong and it was going to be Yom Kippur of 1988. This guy was not a charismatic or a Pentecostal. He was a cessationist. He was an anti-Pentecostal. He was an ultra-fundamentalist Baptist. But he got into this date setting and he was giving out these booklets. And of course, when the Lord didn't come, the hecklers and the Muslims ridiculed them, deservedly so, except they made us all look crazy. There was no talking to them. People setting dates of return of the Lord. We have a mission, a ministry, to pastors of the Hmong tribe and the mountain people in Vietnam, where there's a lot of persecution of the tribal churches by the communist authorities. Pretty bad persecution. I was there a few months ago doing my secret meetings with the pastors. One pastor was there, who was a new believer, and the local communist authorities stirred up, they did it, but good luck. They set his house on fire, and he and one daughter escaped. His wife and his four children were burned alive. And another believer who had been there were burned alive. This, of course, the press doesn't report these things or anything like that. Anyway, I was there, and somebody on shortwave radio translated Harold Camping's prophecy that Jesus was going to come on a certain day. And they got it into Vietnamese, and they put it on shortwave. And some of these pastors listened to it. Now they're being persecuted, and they have an incentive to believe it. When you're being persecuted and you believe the Lord's coming to take you home, you have an incentive to want to believe it. But these are simple people. If you have a Bible, you can get arrested. They allow a limited amount of Bibles in Vietnamese, but not in the tribal languages. They're illegal. You set up a secret printing press and things like that, but anyway. Now I'm there now, right? And these pastors come to me. We call them pastors. Every one of them had been in jail for their faith. Every one of them had been in jail. They took this one guy, came to one of my meetings. They locked him up for 18 days, knocked all of his teeth out. Then they released him so the others would see what happened to him. And then they locked him up again. This is serious. Now, I go to this place to teach these people about the Word of God. And believe me, they teach me what the Word of God is about. When I was seriously ill and almost stunted, I believed that their prayers are more powerful than other people's prayers. I really believe that. These people have nothing to live for but Jesus. They don't have any money. They don't have any... No, they're not. They have nothing. But they don't know much. They're reliant. And they get this Camping, this terrible, crazy man from America. And they ask me, why didn't Jesus come when Brother Camping said? And I find out what happened. They met on some mountain to wait for the rapture. The military police came, killed over 100 of them. They understand. And these poor people didn't know, these pastors didn't know what to tell the people in their churches, their family. Unbelievable. How do I answer them? I had to explain about Jesus warning about false teachers and false prophets in the last days. And they don't know anything, just, they wouldn't, they're so... They wouldn't believe a Christian would lie, you understand? We believed it. It was heartbreaking. That's not how it happened. It's not 1987 or 1988. Millerites, the 19th century, cognitive dissonance, when the failed prophetic predictions of the Millerites, the return of Christ, failed to materialize, it spawned a whole lot of other movements, one of which was the Dawn's Bible Society that became the Jehovah's Witnesses, among others. Seventh-day Adventism came out of it. As another. Hyper-dispensationalists came out of it. As another. Not new. Always there. Always been there. Just take a look at that. take a look at that. Look at this. It's pathetic, isn't it?
That which has been is that which will be.
That which has been done is that which will be done. There's nothing new under the sun. Is there anything of which one might say, see, this is new? No, it's already existed from ages past which were before us. But there's no remembrance, no remembrance of these early creations. And seeing all these things, what's crooked cannot be straight. What's lacking cannot be counted. I've magnified and increased wisdom more than all who were over Jerusalem before me. A wealth of wisdom. My mind has observed these things. Knowledge. I set my mind to know wisdom. When I did, I knew madness and folly. Madness and folly. This is madness and folly. Madness and folly. You got these cowboys running around? Madness and folly. Jehovah's Witnesses, madness and folly. Immersion Church, madness and folly. None of this stuff is new. None of it. I've pointed out multiple times. There have been three major times Eastern religion has invaded Western Christendom. And it didn't begin with the church. Isaiah chapter 2 speaks of it. My people are filled with influences from the East. It took place near the time of Christ in Judaism with Philo. But in Christian history, the first time was with the post-Nicene church fathers. Buddhist monks came from the Far East and from India, and they reached Alexandria. Gnosticism was born into the church from Eastern influence in Alexandria under the leadership of Basilides and Valentinus, and more incipiently people like Origen. Permeated the church. That was the first time. Then when the banking families of Italy sent the Crusades just to control the papacy, to get control of the spice trade to the east, it was revolutionizing the agriculture and economy of Europe. They brought the influences of Hinduism and Islam with them through the Byzantine Empire back to Europe, planting the seeds of what became the Renaissance. Bowing down to statues, counting the prayer on beads, burning the candles and incense before icons. It was the second time. Third time is now. Third time is now. I'll never forget this. We have a large Indian community in England. Similar, in London, a place called Hounslow, similar to what you have in Durban, is a huge diasporic Indian community with people from India. And a group of friends of mine who were pastors from India, or they were Indian pastors in England, but who were born in India and had gotten saved and become pastors in Indian churches. And it's when the laughing drunken thing happened, Pensacola and Toronto, and they watched these videos. What was happening in Toronto and things like this, they said, that is Kundalini Yoga. They knew exactly what it was. My book publisher met with the president of the Royal Society of Stage Hypnotists. He watched Rodney Brown and Benny Hinn and John Arnott. And he said, this is hypnotic induction. Our entertainers can do this on Blackpool Pier for entertainment. Only if they ever did this, they'd never work again. Because they're doing three things our code of ethics are not allowed. They're doing it in the name of religion. They're doing it to children, and they're leaving people in trances. but it's hypnotic. He knew exactly what it was.
There's a move of God in Europe and in Britain among Romani gypsies. A group of friends of mine were Romani gypsy pastors. They watched the same film footage. And again, one of the leaders was Rodney Brown from your country, all the Romans. They said, that's duckery, a Romani gypsy term. I asked her, what's duckery? They said, it's what we used to do before we were saved. It's duckery. I said, well, what is it? They said, they're using the occult to get money out of people. It's with gypsies. They knew who had gotten saved. They knew exactly what it was. People ask me, they've asked you, have you heard of the new thing God is doing? Have you heard of the new move of God? Oh, I heard of the latest truckload of rubbish coming down the pipe hole. But my dear brethren in Christ, I assure you, there's absolutely nothing new about it. The next time some ignoramus, some religious ignoramus, even if they profess to be saved, the next time such an ignoramus tries to tell you that God is doing something new, you may be absolutely 100% confident that the devil is doing something old. Hear what I said? There's nothing new on the sun. There are three basic things that are new. And it's nothing to do with any of this. One, God promised Jeremiah, chapter 31, verse 31. When the Messiah comes, there'll be a new covenant. That's new. Secondly, when somebody is born again, there's a new creation. That's new. Thirdly, when the Lord returns, he will make all things new. There will even be a new heaven and a new world. That's it. The rest of it? The rest of it? And off the La Hadash. Tachat Hashemesh. There is nothing new under the sun. God bless you. Thank you for joining us.